Hi, welcome back to my blog Eddie's English Literature. I am Ardhendu De. Today we are going to read Francis Bacon's Of Studies. I will discuss the text line by line and explain it to you minutely and giving you notes, explanation and all the verbal sayings, his aphoristic style as well as his meaningful rendering of lifestyle and the practical wisdom. The man which we know as the father of essays, father of English essays of course, Francis Bacon's life and his teaching is itself an epoch-making work that we should learn the train of thoughts or the practical wisdom that we practically needed to lead our life. So being a student and missing the train of thoughts from Francis Bacon is making our own learning at risk. So don't taking any kind of risks in that sort. We should study about Francis Bacon. Even though Francis Bacon's essays are little crack, as these are in aphoristic style, in cryptic brevity, in its shortest possible way, he has chosen the words and practically packed those words into wisdom, which is needing a full clarification from you. Otherwise, the meaning of that essay will remain elusive to us. So, I will first discuss Francis Bacon's life and his career, his aphoristic style, his learnedness, and of course, the details of the Of Studies, the current topic that we are taking in our present lecture. Most of Bacon's important works were written in Latin. It was Francis Bacon who says that Latin is more acceptable language than English, and he preferred Latin for a lasting impression. But the pity is that we now represent Bacon as being the first great essayist, the father of English essays in fact. Bacon expressed himself both in English and Latin, and his Latin works are more important, particularly of his Novum Organum and Silvia Silverum, which was even remained left incomplete. His essays, the English work that are essays, which was first published in 1597, which get another two editions, and finally it had 58 odd essays. The Advancement of Learning, the History of Henry VII, and the New Atlantis. All these writings are good. But his essays that we are presently talking about, the first edition it got the publication in 1597, contained 10 essays, and that exhibited Bacon's keen observation of the success it got astonished the author, and after 15 years it was republished and enlarged a volume in 1612, and again in 1625, just before the death of Bacon, the third publication made possible, and in totality it contained 58 essays. His essays, in fact, were not for the common people but for the princes or kings or the aristocratic people of the then time. His essays are compact in the style, terse, pithy, packed with thought, antithetical in structure. The practical wisdom or the notion of living is the essence of his essays. From books, Bacon's turn to man. This was perhaps his greatest contribution to life and literature. Above all, Bacon was very much a man of flesh and blood of his time. Referring to his style, it can be said that Bacon was a philosopher who can only say that he is one of the founders of modern systematic thoughts, that is syllogistic argument. His most important literary works, that is of course essays, might be called as a prologue to his long work The Advancement of Learning, that we can read in later course of our studies. It provides a practical everyday philosophy. What's not in essays cannot be found out in English Elizabethan soil. Every sort of advice is there. Even when he was writing his essays, Bacon had no intention of making a production such a great literature that it will be everlasting one. He wrote those essays only for a mode of instruction for his students or for his readers, and of course they were a novel. But he thought of his essays as certain brief notes set down rather significantly than curious. One thing is quite clear in essays, all of the essays, 58 essays. They are plain, they are meaningful, they are readable. But we need a crasher. We need a crack of the English language. Otherwise, you cannot get the kernel that is hidden under. The prose style, that is the turning point in the history of English literature, the Baconian style, that is aphoristic style, brevity is the very soul of that style. Bacon's essays are very much in a limited sphere with very limited possible words. He packed the wisdom in ultimatum style. The quips, detached, pithy and epigrammatic, these might be the words that it carries. In our daily thoughts, in our reflection to life, in our scientific attachment, in our personal observations of life, in every sphere, the thought of Bacon has touched it. But interestingly, Bacon remained detached from all of this. It is quite not judicial to think that what Bacon says, Bacon believes so. And that is the riddle in Bacon. He doubted the style of Aristotelian mode of teaching theorem. So he left the school. So these are the theories, or these are the argumentative techniques that obviously Bacon was a lawyer, and he put forward the syllogistic argument or logical argument in such a platform that is quite acceptable, because with an ordinary audience don't have the luxury of thought of superseding Baconian argument. So Bacon, the very learned person, has convincingly put forward his statement in affirmative way. But that affirmation is not altogether attached with emotion. Rather, they are pragmatic and practical, way beyond our emotional attachment. That is the basic fault in him. But his language has touched such and such that in our common language, in our daily language, many of the examples, Baconian lines, are giving the very common say of our daily living. For example, take a note. A man that has no virtue in himself ever envied virtue in others. Men fear death as children fear to go in the dark. The French are wiser than they seem, and the Spaniards seem wiser than they are. Revenge is a kind of wild justice. Wives are young men's mistresses, companions for middle age, and old men's nurses. Fame is like a river that beareth up things light and sullen, and drowns things witty and solid. Reading makes a full man, conference ready man, and writing an exact man. The last one is from Op Studies that we are going to read. The essays, in fact, deals as much with public as with private life, discussing great plays, novelty, citizen and troubles, empire, and the true greatness of kingdoms, estates, if not truth, death, parents, children, marriage, envy, love, wisdom, travel. So all sort of things are in the ambit of Bacon's discussion. Bacon speaks as a man of the world, illustrating his generalization by references to history and his own experiences. Bacon describes one of his essays as civil and some as moral. His civil essays, that often deals with political and administrative questions, don't have such interest now as the time has changed a lot. But his moral essays, that really covers the human problems like love, marriage, travel, study, anger, sickness, death, that are truly universal. And Bacon is particularly interesting when he writes about people, writes about the manners and the attached arts with which human beings are dealing his life. If Bacon's essays are devoid of poetry, then where can poetry be found? His prose has become the elegance of poetry. Celian word, the distinction between poets and prose writer, is a vulgar error. So Celi has made the argument that prose and poetry have no distinctive line of differing them. So Bacon's style is aphoristically poetic. If we take Bacon's Of Studies, we can find out it as a popularization. The first edition, it was published in 1597, it was included in it. The exact example of Bacon's prose style can also be found out in this essay. The power of observation is deep and keen. The sentences are antithetical in nature. The prime thing quite paradoxically stated initially, later it has been explained in long, complex sentences. According to Bacon, what he says in Of Studies, studies serve three objectives. They give us pleasure in our alienation. To our formal and informal talk, they add extra glamour. They enable us to form our personality, to justify things judiciously. Bacon advises us to avoid exhibitionism regarding study. Studies cannot be a very good substitute for natural faculties. They can become only inspiration. Without wisdom, they are useless, rather meaningless. After that, Bacon writes about different types of books. Techniques for reading should be different also. Some books are to be read as quickly as possible. Meritorious books should be read in minutely, and light books should be read in brief. He also says the usefulness of different subjects. As for example, history makes men wise by the right kind of physical exercises. The diseases can be removed, rather eradicated. It is same case with human psychology. Different kinds of mental disorder should be restrained by the right kind of studies. So Bacon's essays give us a sum total of our way of studies and our content of studies. Bacon's essays differ from others. These are not written for ordinary men. These are written for princes. And the words, the sentences are to the point, logical, and syllogistic binding is there. And this aphoristic style, this aphoristic statement, and all pragmatic wisdom that we can find out in packed manner in Bacon's Of Studies is worth reading. But the style as and its presentation, the word presentation and its logical binding, is such an interesting study in Of Studies that you should follow line by line with each and every word's meaning clearly. Otherwise, the marks of this particular reading of the Of Studies will not be a successful one. So as the text goes, look at the very first few lines. In Bacon's writing, the style is epigrammatic. The sentence is packed with information.
or in epigrammatic brevity, the first is stated in a gist compact manner, the final statement later in sentences followed, given the explanation of it. It's common like syllogistic argument, as in the laws. Bacon had been a lawyer, so don't forget the very style of his explaining the proposition is like that of a logical argument or a lawyer argument in the bar court. So here it says the initial lines, studies serve for delight, for ornament and for ability. The very three words, delight, ornament and ability, need different connotations. The studies in fact refers to all sort of studies which is related to education. It does not mean only the words, but it all refers to different kind of or different field of studies, be it math, be it science, be it literature, be it psychology, and different field of studies, as well as knowledge it accumulate in different process en route. Delight is for the meaning of pleasure, the joy that one can enjoy through the. So delight is for the pleasure that comes out of mind. It is not a physical pleasure, or rather a joy that comes within from the soul of our heart. Studies lead us for aesthetic pleasure. That pleasure is the meaning of the word delight. And for ornament, ornamentation of one beautifies, or it adds an extra glamour. And that ornamentation is not only for its outer show, but for inner show too. The mind and the sum total of one's persona, that is the character, gets its proper orientation, proper ornamentation through studies. If one leads oneself into perfect studies, his personal quality should exhibit that quality. And for ability, if one studies, if one takes knowledge seriously, he becomes an able person, a capable person of doing something worth his living, worth society. So the first line, like a cryptic argument, like a gist epigrammatic brevity, states the fact that letter has been explained in following lines. Their chief use for delight is in privateness and retiring. How one can be delighted by studies? When someone is in private mood, when someone is retired mood. That means when someone is having its own lonely, when someone is in the sphere of his privacy, when someone is in retirement, detached from the din and bustle of the day, he can fully be delighted by studies. And for ornamentation, that we have just explained, it is in our discourse. In our discourse, in our speech, in our discussion, in our argumentative statements, in our social behavior, everywhere, particularly in our discourse, in our speaking, both in private as well as in social, becomes the subject of intense scrutiny when you are a studied person, when you are a knowledgeable person. So one's speech, one's words are the pillar of one's determination of characters, and that is made possible by proper studies. In fact, Bacon has written of discourse
in his another essays where he explained the importance of speech both in private and in social behavior and how it accumulates one's persona or builds up the very personal capabilities of one's fortune. In the third segment, and that the word that we have just explained is the ability, how the studies put someone an able person. The explanation is that and for ability is in the judgment and disposition of businesses. That means how one can be said capable person, how one can be said able person. That ability is shown in his disposition of business. That means his management of the affairs of life, affairs of social gathering, affairs of any of the private matters. A good management can be done if one is capable, and that capability is earned by studies. Next, Bacon says, for expert man can execute and perhaps judge of particulars one by one, but the general counsels and the plots and marshalling of affairs come best from those that are learned. So here Bacon just wished to say a studied person is a learned one. For expert man can execute, one efficient or a skillful person carry out any of the task he has given or any of the task he just proposes to do himself. But the general counsels, that means the guiding principles that broadly leads one's life, that broadly leads one's capability of stating the affairs of society in its full caliber, is made possible by a learned one. The plots and marshalling of affairs, that means how one should plan, how one should order and manage, as well as arrange or rearrange the different issues, different obstacles in which come best from those that are learned, is best possible or best capable or best way accomplished by a person who is well versed, educated, and who is vastly read. Next, Bacon is quite cautious or give some caution. He suggests that to spend too much time in studies is sloth. Even though studies are good for making a person in its pragmatic guide to lead one's personal success as well as social success, or being able to lead a person to his achieved goal or to its accomplished goal, one should be cautious of spending too much time in studies. If you do so, you will be lazy or you will be idle. To use too much time for ornament is affectation. If you judge each and every matters with the learned topics, then you should be stamped out as artificial and a mere soism. So you will be proved false. Your ornamentation will not be attached to your persona. Then it should be a false ornamentation, and it is affectation. And that affectation will ruin the entire math of learning. Again, he gives another question. To make judgment wholly by their rules is the humor of a scholar. If we take all of the matters of your
lively aspects into a judgment or the parameters of learning principles, expelling all your gained experiences, then you should be as full as that of the scholar, a laughter stock of that scholar who find everything bookish, everything by principles. That should not be the case. You should judge rationally. You should judge by experience, not altogether with that of the learned principles from studies. Otherwise, you should be a humor stock. You should be a person like that of a scholar who is a laughter stock for that kind of attitude.
Bacon further reads,
they perfect nature and are perfected by experience. For natural abilities are like natural plants that need pruning by study. And studies themselves do give forth directions too much at large, except they be bounded in by experience. So Bacon here explains that studies are like that of a natural capabilities, inborn capabilities. Studies does not build anything new. Studies just make a perfections of our natural capabilities, natural qualities, natural human behavior. And those perfection is being perfected by experience. So studies accompanied with experience lead us to be perfectly maturing into our natural capabilities to a meaningful sum that can exhibit the very rules of the society, the very rules of you, and that lead you into a successful man. Here he makes a parallel, a metaphor. For natural abilities are like natural plants that need pruning by study. It simply means that our natural instincts, our natural capabilities or natural abilities are like that of a natural plants. The natural plants that are the wild trees that grows in the jungle are natural. They observe the very rules of the nature, but they need proper cutting and proper seeding, as well as weeding, as well as all of the processes of gardening should be done until it can be placed in a garden. So a natural bush can be perfected into a garden and be given a shaped one with appreciating beauty by its proper cutting, by its proper gardening. Similarly, our natural abilities are wild one. Basically, we are human being and we are like other animals having the animal instinct. But that instinct can be restrained by pruning, by cutting off unwanted ethics, by studies. As like that of a gardener, we should prune our, we should cut off the unwanted abilities from our natural instinct so that we can lead ourselves into our destination. And studies themselves do give forth directions too much at large, except they be bounded in by experience. He again explains that our general and our vogue manner, we should be controlled by studies, but they must be bounded by, they must be controlled by our experiences. If not, rules, regulations, so principles will leave us into or lead us into such a place where no such way of math, no such way of pragmatic way of leading to success be possible. We should not give directions of the studies. We should not give rules and regulations of the studies earned from studies be lead you thoroughly, unless it is be bounded by experiences. All knowledge should be chiseled, should be buttered by the very experience of life. So our studious principles are meaningless if they are not tested by the very principles of experiences. So experiences come handy to make a judgment of our studies. Studies accompanied with experience can lead us to success, otherwise not. Now, in the next few lines, Bacon classifies different kind of people in our society and how they look after the studies or the process of learning and how they make the studies as their ladder as well as a cunning tools. Look at these lines. Crafty men condemn studies, simple men admire them, and wise men use them. So crafty men, those who are clever, deceiving themselves as well as others, they condemn studies. They condemn studies because studies lead us to light, studies lead us to knowledge, and if you are known, the crafty man's cleverness can be caught. For example, we can say so many of them, but we cannot classify them as in every sect of profession there are some crafty people. They just put you or drag you into ignorance to benefit out of it. So a politician will never tell you that what does it mean by democracy, or never explain it to you the very rights of you. If you are given that knowledge, you will claim benefits out of it, and that is very hurting point for his politics. Simple men admire them. So many people of us who just admire the very knowledge, the very studies, the very way to learning, because they simply know that knowledge leads us to light. Simple people, acknowledgement or admiration for knowledge, for the scholars, are the very pillar of the empire of studies, empire of knowledge. Simple people, being simple, they cannot have that capability of learning, but simply admire the learnedness. There are some of the people who are wise. Wise in that sense, they know when to seed, how to seed, and how to grow a plant and pluck the flowers and fruits out of it. So the wise men use them. Each and every of us has some wise instinct. Each and every of us is a wise person because somehow or some way we are studying. And after studying, we are implementing them in its proper way. And that usage, that wiseness, or that kind of wise men or people make the full benefits out of these studies because they use them, implement them. For they teach not their own use, but that is a wisdom without them and above them owned by observation. They are wise people. Why so? A wisdom and knowledge is different thing, or rather interrelated thing, A knowledge is a first-hand experience, a first-hand theoretical examples or theoretical learning of something. But wisdom is gained when that knowledge is tested through experiences. A greater wisdom. So one person's studies can be accompanied with experiences, and that study accompanied with experience make the empire of wisdom, and that wisdom can only be own by observation. So the way of studies must be gone through the lens of experiences, through observations, through minute observations of the implementations of the rules and regulations. And by that observations, what we gain is the empire of wisdom, and that is the ultimatum of learning. Bacon gives us another caution. Read not to contradict and confute, not to believe and take for granted, not to find talk and discourse, but to weigh and consider. What is the purpose of our studies? Suppose we are reading something, and our purpose of reading is not the accumulation of knowledge or gained experience or en route to learning some celestial bliss. Rather, the reading, if lead us to contradict and confute some judgment, and for that purpose we are reading, then it is a disgusting way of learning capability. So one's way of study should not be for the purpose of proving someone wrong or making someone below the grade or finding someone at wrong foot should not be the purpose of studies. Not to believe and take for granted. Even in our way of living, studies do not make us everything to be believable, if not judged by experiences, if not judged by practical notion, or it can be granted in every way in our way of judgment, then the very purpose of the study is spoiled too. So our believing and taking anything for granted wholly with the purpose of studies is a wrong one. Not to find talk and discourse. We should not study only to make our speech and orient it in ornamented way, and to make our learnedness as a show in each and every talk. Women come and go talking about Michelangelo. So this kind of fashionable arguments should not pop up. It would be a kind of sophism. It kind of a mere show of your learnedness, which is not the very purpose of studies. The real purpose of the studies is to weigh and consider. Weigh and consider means only to make your thinking critical, rational, and to consider means to think the other view in a judicial way, in a take for granted way. And that kind of understanding is very essential when you lead yourself into studies. Or the very basic purpose of studies is to weigh and consider. That means to make your judgment rational, critical, as well as considerate. Acceptability of others' argument should be the prime prospect of your studies.
Now, Bacon gives a classification of different kind of books and what one should choose among the host of the books, and the judicial choice of books are given a prime prospect of one's course of learning. If we are going to market, what to buy as per your taste, as per your need, is very essential, same as the buying of the books and reading of the books from the bookshelves. So the pragmatic Bacon says some books are to be tasted, others to be swallowed, and some few to be chewed and digested. Now, epigrammatic this line, what kind of books are to be tasted, which kind of books are to be swallowed, and some few to be chewed and digested. Different kind of eating prospect has been given. Some to be tasted, only the very taste needed. Some to be swallowed, need as a whole. Some for chewing and for digestion. What are the kind of books? That is, some books are to be read only in parts. Some books which are essential, but they are need to be read only in parts. That is a kind of tasting. Others to be read not curiously. Even some of the books are there which are not being curious. Such is not the case of so much attraction, but needed. And some few to be read wholly and with diligence and attention. And some of the books we need whole, with diligence, with attention, we have to read. He explains further that some books also may be read by deputy. There are so many of the books that you don't have to read line by line. You can read it by deputy. Any of the person, any of the teacher can give you the summary and extracts made by them by others. You can read even summary of that books from others. But that would be only in the less important arguments and the minor sort of books. But which kind of books are to be tasted only? The minor sort of books. The books that we don't need them as essential one. Else distilled books are like common distilled waters, flashy things. So caution is there, you cannot take important books as summary. Because if you take important books as summary, those summaries can be flashy things, tasteless things, as that of the distilled waters. Devoid of any minerals, they are tasteless. So the different kind of studies that he says, different kind of categories of books that he says, that if you need summaries, you can take some of the books that you need summaries for your ready references. As a student, we know many of the books which are quite not essential for us, and we just take a summary from a book and just for the passing of the exam. Some books which I have to read minutely, otherwise we can miss a test and we can miss a very whole of the purview of some important topics. So by laws we cannot miss those books. There are some of the books that are very like that of a essential, the rules, regulation of the physics books or mathematical rules, regulation, you have to swallow like that of a medicine. We cannot escape. And even some of the books that enrich your interest or very essential for your progress of life, that is different from each and every person, can be taken for minute discussion, for minute understanding, and
very close reading is essential for that.
Reading makes the full man, conference a ready man, and writing an exact man. So those epigrammatic brevity in this particular line becomes an adage for English people. For the world citizens, it can be told that if you read, you become a full man. A full man means a man with your full capability of expressing you in you. If you confer, if you make conference, if you make conversation, as well as if you have the opportunity of stating your facts on a dais, your reading makes you a ready man. You are always a deliverable person. What you have learned, you can state readily. That ready man, even if someone is learned one, he cannot have the capability of stating all the facts logically or accomplishing the thing in chiseled way unless he or she confers, unless he or she have the opportunity of conference or a meeting or a group working. And if such a learned person have the capability of writing or expressing through words, his learnedness is accompanied by his expression through words, he becomes an exact man. An exact man means the man who never goes wrong. So a ready man, an exact man, and a full man. A person who is full of information, a person who has a quick reply, that is ready man, and a person who is accurate in his logical arguments. So three different kind of persons, three different kind of accepting the studies or way of studies made it possible. So if someone is full of knowledge, that is full man, should venture into a quick-witted person, ready man, and if such a person further toils in writing, he would be an accurate person with logical thinking. Then Bacon explains, and therefore, if a man write little, he had need have a great memory. Suppose one is hardly writing anything. In our studies, we are not writing any of our discussions or notes. Then you need an elephant in our memory. If he confer it, he had need have a present wit. A person who never confer, never participate in debate, what he will do when he takes the opportunity of talking, he will miss something. Otherwise, he need a present wit or a wit just to make up those gaps which he would surely miss in his conference. And if he read little, he had need have much cunning. And even if one person is not at all reading, what he would or she would do, she would make some tricks, some false showing that he knows everything which he actually is not. And if he read little, he had need have much cunning to seem to know that he doth not. Actually, he does not know anything, but he will show that he knows many things. So Bacon says, different kind of books have different benefits. Histories or chronological stories of kings and queens make men wise. Wise means he will know the flow of time, and that understanding will make him wise one. He can even predict the future. The poet's witty. The poets are very meticulous in their choice of words as well as its meaning. So poets lead to wit. If one doing the sums, the mathematics, subt. If someone is full of mathematic calculations or doing the sums, he will be of cool mind and natural philosophy deep. Natural philosophy, that is the science of the then time, or the science as a whole, will make someone deep. He will learn the very basics of life, and that knowledge will make him deep like that of lake. Moral grave, logic and rhetoric able to content. If someone is learning too much moral, he will be a grave person, heavier person with that of moral gravity. And that of logic and rhetoric, able to content. If someone is learning logic and someone is learning how to speak, he will be an able person to content. To content means to make argument presentably. Now Bacon quotes from Ovid's Herodias. He says, abound studies in, that means studies affect characters. Truly said that the different kind of studies have some different effects on our personal upbringing. Nay, there is no stone or impediment in the way, but may be wrought out by the fit studies. He says, in any way of our learning process, if there is any stone or impediment in our way of learning, that can be easily wrought out, that can be easily mended by fit studies, suitable studies. So he explains that like as diseases of the body may have appropriate exercises, as we have different diseases in our body and its remedial is there through appropriate exercises, as he says, bowling is good for the stone and the reins, as does at the then time science says. If someone is having kidney problems, he must have to bowl. Shooting is for lungs and breasts. Shooting exercise is good for lungs and breasts. Gentle walking for stomach. Riding for the head, horse riding of course, and the like. So different kind of exercises at the same time doctor prescribed for different remedial process. Similarly, different kind of studies can be benefited to mend different kind of diseases or different kind of mental illness or incapabilities in us. He says, so if a man which be wandering, let him study the mathematics. If someone is just wandering a bit, if someone is just floating in its idea, not concentrating too much, let him study mathematics. For in his demonstrations, if his wit be called away never so little, he must begin again. Demonstrations means the logical arguments. If someone is not capable of making logical arguments, or always missing some points, he must begin once again the whole of the argumented process or learning. If his wit be not apt to distinguish or find differences, let him study the schoolmen, for they are seminisectors. If one is incapable of making any distinguishes or finding any differences between different things, he must study how to differentiate. Here Bacon refers two things, the schoolmen and the seminisectors. The schoolmen are the philosophers and theologians of the Middle Ages, noted for their hair-splitting logical distinctions. And for seminisectors, Antonius Pius was called seminisectors, the very line seminisectors mean hair splitters, simply, who had even capable of making seminisid bisecting, or a divider of seminisids, which is very smaller one. So hair splitters or seminisectors or the schoolmen are those philosophers who have the capability or the logical distinctions they made, have the capability of hair splitting any of the arguments. So let them study. So these are the law references. As Bacon had been a lawyer, so he prefers that law references here, that one should study seminisectors or those schoolmen to make a distinction between different things. If he be not apt to beat over matters and to call up one thing to prove and illustrate another, let him study the lawyer cases. If one is even cannot make something remedial or rather corrected any of the matters, or cannot even recall or cannot even prosecute any of the things in proper way, if he is incapable of proving or illustrating any of the things, one should study the lawyer cases. The lawyer cases are tediously boring but lengthy and logically interesting. So such interesting logical arguments, even though it is bored one, can make their argumentative technique corrected. So another law references, another explanation from laws that he wishes to show. If someone is just getting slow and slow how to make arguments in proper way, if someone is slow, incapable of making the arguments in a fast or logical way, he must take the lawyer cases properly. So in the final lines, Bacon say, so every defeat of the mind may have a partial receipt. So if there is any deficiency of mind, it can be get a partial receipt or prescriptions or partial remedial process by studies. So whole of this essay by Francis Bacon is full of aphorism, full of pragmatic wisdom that one should take as for references for their future understanding of how to study and what to study. But one question must be said, that we should not take Bacon in its total learnedness without learning his faults. One part of the Bacon had been the meanest. He himself has been corrupt. He was jailed, executed. So somehow the Bacon, the very person, is not without doubt. So whatever he says or whatever the argument it states, even though they are logically binding, how they are fruitful in its full caliber, how are they to be suitable for you, can be a final judge by you. and not by Bacon, because too much logic without fancy leads you nowhere, and too much fancy without logic cannot go in either way. So we need a middle way. Somewhere some imagination, somewhere some fascination, somewhere some fancy is most essential, along with those long columns, tall columns of logic.
As we have gone through our studies and have studied the text minutely, with the meaning, with the explanation, and with its aphoristic brevity, we are now able to grasp the meaning of the Bacon's other essays too, as this type of sayings or this type of aphoristic style, we follow them in other essays too. And the stylistic manner which he has rendered in his op studies is quite common in other studies. I think it will be a great beneficial to you. The practical wisdom that he has rendered can be a help to your practical way of living, and the study that you have read through Bacon's op studies might be a great help for literary students to understand the very flow of Bacon's style and the Renaissance segment of learning. And if there is still any doubts regarding of studies, you can just pop up any question. I will try my best to answer it. So like, share, comment, and don't forget to subscribe. Bye bye.